good evening. My name is Stevenson. Tyrod Stevenson here.
With a package I got in the mail, I'm gonna show you what's inside here. So I wanted to do a Halloween-themed upload this weekend. I wanted to share some scary movies or scary video games. But I just couldn't pass up the James Bond theme this week because of what's in this package I got from a friend. And not only that, but last night, downtown Modesto at the State Theater played From Russia With Love. So I got all decked out in this outfit here. It cost me only $15. Got all this stuff at the thrift store. And had a great time. So I guess it is sort of Halloween themed. I have an outfit on. I'll probably wear this when I take my kids out trick-or-treating again, so I'll get two uses out of it. Well, three counting this video. So anyway, my good buddy Hidden Game Room, HGR, sent me this package. He said he's gonna send me something I would like. And I'll show you the letter he sent to me. And I definitely do like what's in here. It has to do with the theme I got going on today. But he sent me a letter within the package, and I'll read that to you. I'll try to use my little voice-changing cue device from Diamonds Are Forever when I read this, so I sound like HGR.
Tylord, sorry not a lot of games, but I think you like what's in the box. Your friend, HGR.
Okay, that wasn't too good. But HGR has a channel. He does a lot of collection videos and pickup videos. He picks up a lot of good stuff. And his videos are very intricate too. If you watch him, he has video footage of pretty much everything he picks up going on all at once on the screen. So a lot of the stuff he picks up, if you're not familiar with it, he'll have it on display as he's sharing it. I don't have the technology for that yet. I still have a Nintendo and a CRT right here, but one day. Anyway, what all HCR sent me was looks like this complete set of 007 movies. And I didn't have this complete set. I had From Russia With Love and Dr. No. These are the only two I had. He sent me, looks like, the whole set. It must have ended at A View to a Kill with this set. I don't know if it went into the Dalton movies. But anyway, I want to share these and tell you how I feel about these movies. These are some of my favorite movies. I don't think they're very many movies I like more than Bond movies. Jaws is up there, of course. Anyway, so I'll go through these in chronological order here, by the year they were filmed and released. Okay, so the first one here, Dr. No, released in 1962. I think this movie had $1 million budget, which was pretty good back then. Terrence Young directed it. He directed two more after this. This is a fun little spy movie, a little adventure. I don't want to give too much of it away. I encourage everyone to go watch all these Bond movies. You could tell from the start this guy Connery was a stud here. Next one, released a year later, From Russia With Love. This is the one I watched a lot when I was a kid. Terrence Young comes back to direct it. Sean Connery's in it again. This is Q's first appearance, or Desmond Llewellyn's first appearance as Q. Q had a small part in Dr. No, but was not the same actor. The one we've come to know, that Q started off in this one. So this is where it starts off with all of his gadgets. Dr. No wasn't heavy on the gadgets, other than there was like a Geiger counter. Anyway, he starts getting gadgets in this one, like exploding briefcases and whatnot. Anyway, so I've seen this movie a million times, but last night it was playing at the State Theater. There was a charity event put on by the Bronco Wine Company to benefit the Parent Resource Center. So I didn't mind spending money. I got two tickets. So I went and saw this. My wife wouldn't go with me. My wife is a Bond fan, actually, but she was caught up making cookies for her sister-in-law. So I was really bummed my wife didn't go. So I had to take my sister, which is cool, because she kind of liked Bond when we were kids, too. But I even had, like, the most attractive girl at my work said she would go with me to see this. So I thought maybe that would make my wife want to go. But that didn't help. She still didn't want to go. Anyway, but I thought it would be weird anyway, so I went with my sister. My sister seemed to enjoy it. But the thing with this movie, my sister said it was corny. Like, she said she liked it, but she said it was corny. I always thought this was the most, like, one of the more down-to-earth ones, one of the more realistic ones. But my sis thought it was corny. It's just an old movie. I think it holds up well. Anyway, Robert Shaw's in here, and he's a scary dude. Him and Connery duke it out at the end. They never really meet till the end. They don't come in contact with each other till the end. There's a they have a pretty good fight aboard the train, the Orient Express. Okay, next one, Goldfinger, 1964. This is the first one that Guy Hamilton directed. This is a lot of people's favorite. I don't blame them. This is like one of the first Bond movies I saw when I was a kid, and I watched it over and over. My wife doesn't like it. She thinks it's slow. I think it's pretty intriguing movie, good plot. The build-up is really good. The end, there's a lot going on at the end. This has a really good villain, Goldfinger, and one of the best henchmen, Oddjob. He was a pro wrestler, and no, he's not a midget. Everyone thinks Oddjob is a midget because of GoldenEye on Nintendo 64. He might be short, he might be 5'7 to 5'10, but he's not a midget. He's a big buff dude, he's not a midget. Everyone just thinks of Oddjob from GoldenEye, but he's the henchman in Goldfinger. Oh, a lot of pretty blondes in here too. This Honor Blackman plays Pushy Galore. Apparently she was 38 in this, and that's one of the oldest Bond girls. You wouldn't know it. She kind of has a maturity about her. But she looks very young, like 20s, early 20s. But I guess that was one of the oldest Bond girls at the time. With a lot of pretty blonde Bond girls in this one. Oh, this is the debut of the DB5, the Aston Martin. The first like Q-Lab scene kind of paved the way for later Bond movies. You always have the classic Q scene inside the lab. It all started with this one. Oh, and the budget for this one was $3 million, I guess. Dr. No was $1 million. The budget for Marshall Love was $2 million. This was $3 million. And they were cranking them out every year at this point. And then Thunderball came out a year later, 1965, and this one cost $6 million, so it doubled from Goldfinger. And it shows in here, this one has a lot of intricate underwater shots, a lot of underwater battles. There's a big battle between like two armies of frogmen. His DB5 has a brief appearance in here. I think this is the last time you saw his DB5 in a movie until GoldenEye. And a lot of pretty shots of the Bahamas in here, pretty locations in this movie. Oh, gorgeous girls in here, a lot of cute brunettes and a redhead in here. And then 2 years later, 1967, You Only Live Twice. And this is the first one directed by Lewis Gilbert. He'll come back later on. I lost track of the budget after Thunderball. This had to cost more than Thunderball. There's a huge hollowed out volcano layer, like a huge Spectre base. I think it was built at Pinewood Studios. It was a big intricate layout. This one takes a place a lot in Japan. You get a little Japanese culture in here. One of the thugs that Bond fights in this movie is actually The Rock's granddad. So The Rock's granddad, you know, The Rock, the wrestler, he was probably one of my favorite wrestlers at that time. Yeah, so The Rock's granddad fights with James Bond in this. And then the villain in here is Blofeld, Ernst Avril Blofeld. He shows up a lot at this point. He's the head of Spectre, you know, the guy with a cat that Dr. Evil is based on. And he's played by Donald Pleasance. You probably know him from the Halloween 1 and 2. And this has a great big battle between henchmen and ninjas at the end. Okay, and here's the first one not starring Sean Connery. This is George Lazenby's debut as Bond, first and only. And this one is the first and only one directed by Peter Hunt. And this is 1969. And man, this is a banger of a movie right here. Oh, look, this one has a a Pink Panther sort in it. I didn't know about that. Whatever. Anyway, this one's really good. Back when I was a kid, I kind of shied away from it, because like, who's that guy? He's not Sean Connery, and he's not Roger Moore. I mostly saw the Roger Moore and Connery ones, but this guy Lazenby's a stud. Apparently, he had never even acted before he got to this role. He auditioned and he just made up lies about his acting history. And the producers and everyone believed them. I don't buy that though. He had to have acted before this because he pulls it off great. He pretty much just pulls off Sean Connery in this. It would have been cool to have Sean Connery in this, but this guy pulls it off well. He's a stud too. He does his little hand-to-hand fights. He looks like a stud. But Peter Hunt, anyway, the director Peter Hunt, prior to this movie, he had done the editing in the previous Bond movies. I always thought the editing in the Bond movies were spot on. So he probably knew these movies in and out. So that was another, probably one of the reasons why this movie came out so good. And then Telly Savalas plays Blofeld in here. He plays the villain. And he's probably one of my favorite Blofelds because he's not really kind of a weeny little guy like Donald Pleasance. He's kind of a tough dude. Like, he can hold his own with Bond in a fight. Yet he still seems very intellectual, very menacing in every way. So Telly Savalas is probably one of my top two Blofelds. And some of the filming locations in here are gorgeous too, like in Switzerland. Oh, Diana Rigg from the Avengers TV show. She's gorgeous in here. She's probably a lot of people's favorite Bond girl. And she can hold her own too. She actually has a fight with one of the henchmen at the end. Yeah, this is the build up in this one's slow but intriguing. The last 45 minutes of this movie, pure action. And then on to a 1971, Diamonds Are Forever. Guy Hamilton returns to direct this one. He directed Goldfinger. So second one, and look who else is back. Sean Connery came back for a lot of money. George was out. I'm really glad Sean Connery came back. I was really happy to see him in this. This is probably one of my favorite Sean Connery performances. Man, he's just so smug and cool in this movie. He's kind of older too. Everyone says he's fat and old in this, but I wish I was in his shape in this movie. So he's probably about 41 in this movie. But man, this movie is, I just love this movie. It kind of has the Goldfinger humor. Guy Hamilton directs it. This one takes place in the United States in Las Vegas. That's might be why I liked it, because I've been to Las Vegas. I actually, my wife and I, our honeymoon, we went to Vegas, and we stayed at Circus just so I could stay at a place that was a Bond location. That's the only Bond location I can afford, Circus in Vegas. But yeah, dude, this is a movie about diamond smuggling and Inspector's grand scheme, or Blofeld's grand scheme to use the diamonds to make a laser. But what's his name? Charles Gray plays Blofeld in here. He's nothing like Donald Pleasance nor Telly Savalas. But I really like Charles Gray as Blofeld. He's just such a fussy, stuck-up Blofeld. The two henchmen in here are classic. Mr. Kidd and Mr. Wendt. The two gay hitmen, they're hilarious. Anyway, the guy that plays Mr. Wendt is George McFly's dad. You can kind of tell it's George McFly's dad. He kind of looks like him. He's a creepy gay hitman in here, and his buddy Mr. Kidd. They are some awesome henchmen in this. Oh, some pretty American girls in here too. A brunette and a redhead. Jill St. John. A lot of people don't like her in this because she gets kind of ditzy towards the end, but I think she's hilarious. Oh, the Felix Leiter in here I really like. A lot of people don't like him. Usually when I think Felix Leiter in my mind, I think of this guy in here. I don't know why. Maybe because this is one of my favorites when I was a kid. This is one where they really ramp up the action too. There's a lot of car chases and moon buggy chases, a lot of sneaking around. I really like this movie. It has a really good sense of humor too. A lot of good dialogue too. Someone could say the editing is bad in this one. I'll agree it doesn't have the best editing in the series. It has some issues. But overall, like, it's edited really well. I really enjoy this movie. Okay, and then 1973, Roger Moore's first outing as Bond. Hey, like, another Pink Panther short. Hey, these all must have a Pink Panther short in this series. I just noticed that right now. Okay. Roger Moore is in here. Roger Moore is a stud. I don't care what anyone says. He's probably my favorite Bond. He's either equal or a little higher than Connery for me. Everyone says his movies are corny and silly and he's a cornball and this and that, but I mean, he's pulled off some pretty serious scenes too, so I don't know why everyone gets on him for being silly. He is pretty funny though. This movie has some good humor. It's Guy Hamilton directs this again. He directed the last one, Diamonds Are Forever, and then Goldfinger. All of the Hamilton ones have a certain flavor. Man, this one has a lot of action. The last hour of this movie, just nonstop action. I don't know what the budget is for this, but there's car chases, there's boat chases, there's an underground lair, there's sharks, there's alligators. This is an awesome action movie here. The bad guy in here is really underrated. That man, his name is Yaphet Kotto. You've probably seen him in Aliens, the black guy in Alien, and he was in The Running Man. He was Arnold's buddy in The Running Man. He plays a Mr. Big in this. Mr. Big is probably one of the best villains up to this time. He's really suave and smart, but he can handle himself in a fight too. And all the best henchmen are in this movie, I'm telling you. And there's a ton of cool henchmen in this movie. Oh, the Solitaire is played by Jane Seymour. And if you see Jane Seymour now, she's got to be in her 60s. She still looks fantastic. In this movie, she was probably very young, very early 20s. She's gorgeous. Making out with old Roger here. He's probably 40. Yeah, but if you're not into Bond movies because you think they're boring, I don't know why you would. But you're kind of interested. I would start with this one. This one has some really good stunts. It's before all this computer-generated stuff. There's some really scary looking stunts in this. And then the very next year, The Man with the Golden Gun, 1974. Apparently this one had a lower budget. A lot of people don't like this one. It has a pretty intricate villain layer at the end, but there aren't a lot of henchmen. There's not really a big battle or anything at the end, like most of them. But I think it makes it up for it in the other areas. It's a pretty cool plot. The villain in here is one of the best. Christopher Lee plays Francisco Scaramanga, the guy with the man with the golden gun. He's the villain in this. This is my favorite Christopher Lee characters. You probably know him from Dracula. He played Dracula in those older Hammer movies, and everyone knows who Christopher Lee is. This is my favorite movie with him. He's kind of like the part he plays, he's sort of like an evil 007. He pretty much has all the skills and the abilities as Bond, but he uses his skills to kill people for money. This is Roger Moore's second movie. This is one of the reasons, like, I don't see why Roger Moore is supposed to be silly and lighthearted. He's kind of a jerk in this movie. He's kind of dark and he's grumpy, he's crabby all the time. Probably even more so than Connery ever was in this particular movie. This is Guy Hamilton's last movie, so it still kind of has a sense of humor. This has the little midget guy, Nick Knack, from Fantasy Island. He's a pretty cool little henchman. Maude Adams is in here. She comes back later on to play another Bond girl. Britt Eklund. Oh my lord. You could tell this movie came out around the same time as Enter the Dragon. A lot of times Bond movies borrow from whatever's popular at the time. This one was like martial arts themed. A lot of it kind of reminded me of Enter the Dragon. There's quite a bit of kung fu in here. The last showdown at the end between Bond and the man with the golden guns in a fun house, it kind of reminds me of the mirror maze at the end of Enter the Dragon. I don't know if it's just me. Anyway, Man with the Golden Gun, I like it. Okay, and then skip ahead a few years, The Spy Who Loved Me, 1977. Man, this was always my favorite one as a kid. And here comes Lewis Gilbert back to direct it. Earlier on, he directed You Only Live Twice. Yeah, Roger Moore's third outing as Bond. The first appearance of Jaws, the 7'2" henchman with steel teeth. Really scary henchman. He was kind of like the Terminator before the Terminator. No matter what Bond did to him, he always came back. You always think he's dead, but he comes back again. This movie just flows really well. This is another one I would recommend if you've never seen a Bond movie. Watch The Spy Who Loved Me. This just flows so nicely, this movie. I really love the cinematography in this movie. It's just a gorgeous movie. And then the set designs are amazing. This movie had to cost a fortune. I didn't keep up with the budget of the movies at this point. But there are so many, the interiors of these ships, and there's an underwater city. Just really intricate sets. A lot of underwater fighting in this movie. This is the one where the car turns into the submarine, the Lotus. What else? A gorgeous Bond girl. Yeah, Barbara Bach, Ringo Starr's wife, was the KGB agent that teamed up with Bond. A lot of really good stunts in this movie as well. This is the one where Bond skis off of the cliff and then parachutes. Union Jack parachute comes out, or the stuntman does. Yeah, Richard Kiel, that Jaws, he's always been my favorite henchman. I used to dress up like him when I was a kid. I think I was him for Halloween. I actually got Richard Kiel's autograph like a week before he passed away. So I'm glad I finally got to meet him, because I always wanted to meet him. He lives around my area, but I never met him. But I got to meet him at an event. I took a picture with him and he signed my Moonraker poster. But unfortunately he passed away a couple weeks after that. And then this one, kind of shark themed. This is another thing I noticed Bond movies borrow from popular movies at the time. Jaws had just come out, and there's quite a few sharks in this movie. And then of course the henchman's name is Jaws. So that's just something else I've noticed. Okay, and then on to 1979's Moonraker. This is my favorite movie. I know a lot of people will hate on me for this, but I really love this movie. This is the year I was born, 1979. I just love this movie. It's so epic and on such a huge scale. And Roger Moore is back. This is Lewis Gilbert back to direct for the third time. It's pretty much the same plot as The Spy Who Loved Me. Only instead of underwater, it goes to outer space. A lot of people think it gets corny towards the end. I don't mind it. Here's another movie that I think was influenced by what was happening at the time with influenced by other popular movies at the time. Star Wars had come out in 1977. Here comes Moonraker in 1979. It was supposed to be For Your Eyes Only, but I think they pushed this out to ride on that Star Wars wave, like a space sci-fi themed movie. I'm sorry, but I like this more than Star Wars. Star Wars is awesome, of course. I just like Bond. I just like the Bond universe, and seeing it go to that next level up to space is awesome. And then Jaws returns. Richard Kiel returns as the villain's henchman. A lot of pretty locations in this movie too. The first half of the movie, classic Bond, traveling around. He's in Rio de Janeiro, he's in Venice. Great sneaky Bond detective work, the beginning of the movie. The end of the movie sort of ends up with a battle in space. Kind of reminds me of Thunderball's battle underwater, but this is in space. The Americans are fighting with the villain's henchmen up in space with laser guns and everything. But it still kind of has that Bond feel, the classic kind of like You Only Live Twice type battle at the end, a big epic battle. Same director though, Lewis Gilbert. I have such a crush on this Bond girl. She's one of my favorites. Her name is Lois Childs. She plays Dr. Goodhead. Oh, a lot of gorgeous girls in here. I think Bond goes through about four of them in here. Oh, and this is one of the best scores. I really love John Barry's scoring here. You don't really hear the Bond theme a lot, which usually I don't like it at all when they don't put the Bond theme in. A lot of the newer movies never put the Bond theme in. This one doesn't have it too much, but just the overall score of this movie is gorgeous. Like, I used to just listen to this when I read or if I was doing homework or whatever. I just love the soundtrack in this movie. On to 1981, and here comes Roger Moore again in For Your Eyes Only. And this is John Glenn's first Bond movie. He went on to do four more after this consecutively. And I freaking love John Glenn's James Bond movies. He directed Bond throughout the 80s. And he was like an in-house director too, kind of like how Peter Hunt was for On Her Majesty's Secret Service. John Glenn had previously done like second unit directing, I think, but mostly editing. He'd edited a lot of Bond movies up to this point. So man, when he got to this one, he had it down already. These John Glenn movies are just so good to me. And this one gets away from the corny campiness. I mean, it's still corny. All Bond movies are corny and campy in some way, but it gets away from the far-fetched stuff, the outer space stuff. It kind of takes it back down a notch. He doesn't use too many gadgets. Well, he does have a few gadgets, but he mostly uses... He's more resourceful in this movie. And it's more down-to-earth plot. It's nothing... nothing... Like, the whole world isn't on the line. Roger Moore is still a stud. He's got to be in his mid-50s in this. But I think he's still a stud. I think I heard in the director's commentary, he said he got in way better shape for this. He's pretty fit for an older dude. And Julian Glover is in here. He plays the villain. Not too memorable of a villain, but I think he's really good. Julian Glover actually played a villain in Empire Strikes Back. And he played a villain in an Indiana Jones movie, so he's covered all of those. I think he's in... I don't watch Game of Thrones, but I think he's been in Game of Thrones. Man, I could go on about this movie forever. This has some great stunts in it, too. It's set during, like, the Olympics in Italy. And it just has so much action going on, like ski chases, skiing through bobsled courses. There's a lot of underwater battles. This one covers everything. Like, as far as Bond action, there's underwater action, there's skiing action, there's car chases. Three of these Roger Moore movies were not scored by John Barry. This is one of them. Bill Conti, that did the Rocky movies, did this, and it's like, I can't think of anyone better to replace John Barry for one movie. This soundtrack in here is awesome. Getting close to the end, I'm sorry. Okay, Octopussy. This is the one I always thought was the best when I was a kid. So much action. This is probably the second best action movie ever made as far as I'm concerned after Commando, but I'm not saying Commando is better than this. I like this more than Commando, but I'm just saying as far as an action movie goes, Commando's up on top. But man, this comes really close. There's so much action, so many good stunts in here. I think people just don't take it seriously because old Roger is in here. And that never bothered me. Like, he seems like a fit, nimble old dude. Oh, and Maude Adams comes back. She had previously played a Bond girl in The Man with the Golden Gun. She comes back as the lead lady in here, Octopussy. The villains in here are really underrated, too. The actor, he was in Beverly Hills Cop 2. His name is Burkoff or something. The guy that plays the evil Russian general, he's a really good villain, really scary. I think he's like up there with Goldfinger, he's just nuts. And then the other guy, his name is Louis Jordan. He's a really cool villain, really sleazy, arrogant villain. Anyway, just like the perfect combination of the acting of Roger Moore, the directing of... John Glenn, the music of John Barry, and the production design of Peter Lamont. Okay, and then the last one in this set here, 1985's A View to a Kill. John Glenn directed it again. Roger Moore's last appearance as Bond. I love this movie. I know a lot of people don't like this one either. They refer to this one as the guilty pleasure one if they like it. I don't see anything wrong with it. I don't mind Roger Moore being old. He's like a cool old stud. It's kind of weird the girl is so young, or the girls he's making love to and making out with are so young. But come on, he's a stud, he's Bond. Yeah, Christopher Walken is the bad guy in here. Kind of a Donald Trump type character. His name is Max Zorin in here. Kind of reminds me of young Donald Trump. Walken came back again to do that Batman movie, or Batman Returns. He played Max Schreck. He was kind of like similar to the character in here, Max Zorin. This guy's even more of a nutcase, though. Max Zorin. Really cool villain. Kind of dark movie. Like, he does some pretty gruesome things. He's like a psychopath, this guy, Max Zorin. Grace Jones is the henchwoman in here. She's probably one of the most well-known hench people. I think she's pretty cool. Apparently she was dating Dolph Lundgren at this time, and Dolph Lundgren has a small appearance in this movie. Oh, Tanya Roberts here, the cute blonde from the 80s. There were a lot of them. But I mean, a lot of people get irritated with her. She screams all the time, and she's ditzy, and she doesn't seem like she could be a geologist. I don't know, never really gave much thought to it. Never really bothered me. Patrick McNee from the Avengers is Bond's sidekick in here for a while. They have pretty cool chemistry, Roger and that Patrick McNee. I think at one point they played Sherlock Holmes and Watson. I think it was like Sherlock Holmes Goes to New York, one of those old movies. Yeah, a lot of this movie was filmed in San Francisco. So this is one of the few Bond locations I've been to. I kind of want to go back and look at some of the locations from the movie, like City Hall and the Dunsmuir Estate in Oakland, California. I've been wanting to take a day trip over there with my wife and look at that pretty Dunsmuir Estate. They use this in this movie. It's where Stacy Sutton lives. There's kind of like an action scene there, and some romantic scenes. Anyway, the last one in this set, View to a Kill, love it, 1985. One of my favorite 80s movies. And then not only did good old HGR send me all those Bond movies that I can gush about, I'll probably never actually watch them. I'll just display them in my collection because I have them on DVD. Not only did he send me all those, he sent me some other goodies. Simpsons, the movie on DVD, and I did not have that. I don't think I've seen this since it's been at the theater. I went and saw it at the theater with my wife. So good to have Simpsons, the movie. And then I guess he sent me this to keep up with the spy theme. Metal Gear Solid 4, which I've never played. I didn't really care. I give the first three a try, but I could not get into them. I've never given this one a try. But I actually already have this in my collection. I got it for cheap. So if anyone needs this, let me know. I'll probably keep this one and give away my my other copy. Anyway, cool to have this. I should give them another chance. I just was never into those. This looks like it's a World War II movie with Clint Eastwood and Richard Burton, Where Eagles Dare, from 1968. Wow, this might be pretty cool. I don't think I've ever seen this. It looks like it's a spy movie. Yeah, this I probably would really like this. And then I got the old 2001, Stanley Kubrick's 2001. That's cool to have this. I had this in a little compilation pack, but now I have the actual DVD. This will go good with my Full Metal Jacket. Tony, that video game collector, sent me a Full Metal Jacket, so now I have this and now I have Full Metal Jacket and 2001. And then he sent me keeping up with the Cold War theme. I assume that's what this is. Nuclear Strike. I don't know anything about this game. It's a PlayStation 1 game, so it'll play on anything PlayStation I have. Nuclear Strike. I'm guessing it's a real-time strategy game. I'm not sure. But cool to have that. And then he knows I'm a big Jaws fan. He sent me Jaws the novel. I already have this and I've read it. I love this book, but I can't have too many of these because I like to give them away to people who, I try to hype these books up so much. This is Peter Benchley's Jaws. I don't like it as much as the movie, of course, but the book is great. A lot of stuff happens in the book that's really disturbing that's not in the movie. Anyway, I really like the sequels by Hank Searles. But yeah, I'll take as many copies of this as I can get because I like to share it with others. Anyway, that's about it. I just wanted to use that package to gush about my love for James Bond movies. I don't have a lot of James Bond friends around here. Not even really on the internet. I listen to James Bond radio every week. And sometimes I interact with people online talking about James Bond, but mostly my good friends online are like video game people. And all my buddies around here, we just geek out about movies and video games. I don't really have any good Bond friends other than my wife. I'm lucky, the only girl I know that's into Bond I married. Anyway, thanks a lot for sticking around if you've lasted this long. I'll see you next time when my beard grows back. Bye!